Welcome to a sports betting podcast from pregame.com for the week of October 1st, 2009. I'm your host, RJ Bell. I'm joined by Vegas Runner, a genuine professional bettor here in Vegas, and Marco D'Angelo, 30 years in the business. This is segment 1 of 5, and the subject is NFL parity. What does it mean for the handicapper? All right, Marco, it seems like a lot of parity, a lot of good teams seemingly are losing, a lot of bad teams seemingly are winning. What does it mean to the handicapper?
Well, from a handicapping standpoint, you got to try to stay ahead of the curve. The odds makers here in Vegas set these numbers, but I found over the years that they're slower to react to teams that were expected to be good whenever they start out bad. They're slow to adjust their numbers.
All right, so let's think about that. If a team is expected to be good but starts out bad, so Tennessee would fall into that category. 0-3 right now. Last year they had the most wins in football.
Absolutely.
So that's a situation you're saying that there just seems to be a continued belief that this is a good team.
You saw it last week when the line continued, and I lost the free pick last week on Tennessee. You know, I did fall into the trap with that game. Tennessee, the line continued to come down. The public still did not believe in the Jets, who are the upstart team, and they're still believing in Tennessee from last year. There's two other teams, if you think about it, that are won their divisions last year. They haven't won a game yet this year, and that's Carolina and Miami. Now, Miami obviously has more problems with Chad Pennington gone for the season, but Carolina's another team that was expected to win their division again, and they haven't even won a game yet.
All right, so let's make sure, and we'll go to Vegas Runner here, that we need to avoid the water cooler type talk. All right, there's some teams that were supposed to do well
right.
that aren't. All right, we got it, and you get that on Colin Cowherd and Mike and Mike. For the batter, what's it mean?
I think that by now, after seeing 3 weeks, you could believe what you've seen and not necessarily believe what the odds makers are putting out. And I think the public's done a good job of that.
So what you're saying is the odds makers are putting out a number assuming these teams like Tennessee still are good.
Correct.
And you're saying after 3 weeks, you're looking at the 3 weeks and saying, no, my assessment's different.
Yeah, it took them until this week to finally adjust New Orleans to admit that they're a good team. They had them down at 8th last week. You know, while they'll still keep a Pittsburgh up top, they'll still keep a New England up top. And I think the public's done a good job of seeing this, and that's why they've beaten the books in the pros this year.
All right, so what you're saying, all right, so this is the flip side, is the team that, though New Orleans did gain, you had them actually, what, about
yeah,
5-6 weeks
did.
Ago now, as a future bet of 22-1. They became a darling even before the season started, but now they're ranked, what, 4th this week in the odds makers poll?
Mm-hmm.
So Vegas says this is the 4th best team in football.
Finally.
Finally, but they were the 8th best team in football last week.
Correct.
Was their assessment.
And they're covering the number.
So this is an example of what you were talking about, in which this is a team that is doing better than expected, and the lines makers are quick to accept that.
Right. They'll make the adjustments quicker, but they'll still believe in, you know, the big teams. And one of the games we'll talk about later in the podcast this week is the Sunday night game, the Pittsburgh Steelers in San Diego. The number's still up on Pittsburgh, and they have underperformed, you know, in their last two games. They've played, you know, they've made mistakes in the fourth quarter, and yet that line opened up, I believe, at 5 or 5.5, and it's
shot
up to
right
six
out.
Up to 6.5. The public just doesn't want to believe that teams aren't as good as they were last year.
All right, so one of our takeaways for the batters are, and let's make sure we drill down into this, is if there's a team that's legitimately not as good as expected, and that's going to be the distinction, legitimately. So let's just set that aside and forget that distinction just for a minute. If there's a team that is not doing as well as expected, the lines makers are slow to react, thus fading that team has some value. Now let's talk about the teams that fall in this category and ask ourselves a quick yes or no, and we'll start with you, VR. Are these teams legitimately not playing well? Like Pittsburgh, for example, I'm a huge Steeler fan. I watch every game, every play I try. I think this team is as good as expected entering the year. I think that their injuries on defense and a couple, you know, they could easily be 3-0 and we wouldn't be having this discussion. Clearly there's something wrong on D. We've yet to see that. I don't think they're the best team in football. I think they're amongst the top 5 or 6 best teams.
Yeah, you got to keep them up top. And like you said, it's injuries and things like that that has stopped that team from being possibly 3-0.
Or one injury.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
I mean, because they really haven't had other injuries. So, okay, so Pittsburgh, I'm not looking to fade in general, though they're a public darling, so you're usually paying a premium with the Steelers no matter what. Tennessee, are they right now they're considered to be a good team, even at 0-3. Is that true or not?
I don't think they are, RJ. I really don't. I think Collins' age has really shown. I think they're a team, if their running game doesn't get 130 yards, they can't win a game. So I think you definitely have to lower the stock in Tennessee.
2 points on Tennessee. They lost Haynesworth, you know, that went
defensive
to Washington.
Stopper.
That was a big loss for them. And there's a reason Kerry Collins has bounced all over the NFL. I mean, he's played for how many different teams? He just never has two good years in a row. You know, and he had a good year last year, and he's just not doing it this year.
All right, so for example, and I have the open here, Tennessee is laying 1.5 at Jacksonville. So in theory, then it's saying 4.5 points better Tennessee is than Jacksonville, because Jacksonville should be -3 at home if it's 4.5 point difference. Now that's significant. Now Jacksonville was at Houston last week and only getting 4, which means that you're saying Houston is only 1 point better than Jacksonville entering that game, and you're saying 4.5 points better is Tennessee than Jacksonville. So it seems like the lines makers still really like this team. You guys don't.
Yeah, they're not willing to adjust that number enough, I don't think.
And that's a potential value.
Absolutely.
All right, New England is a team that clearly hasn't played as well as expected. Forget their record for a minute. Their performance, they could have lost to Buffalo easily and be 1-2. And this is an example where they opened that number at 3 against Baltimore and was quickly bet down by the wise guys.
I'm of the opinion that I think they rushed the judgment too much on this New England team, and I think it's based more on how strong Baltimore looks than a negative against New England.
So when you say they, you mean the wise guys betting?
Correct. And where the odds maker has lowered the stock in New England. This line, the future line for this game, was 7.5. So that's a 4-point adjustment, 5-point adjustment.
When you say future line, you mean preseason they had a line on this game at 7.5.
That you could have bet in August, and New England was a 7.5-point favor over Baltimore, who was 11-5 last year, let's not forget.
The point I was going to put in there is at the beginning of the year, this team was one game from the Super Bowl, Baltimore, yet they came out with the season win total on Baltimore this year of 8.5. You know, say it, you know, that the public odds makers said that this team wasn't good.
Right.
They've underestimated Baltimore from the word go.
And that's why they're 3-0 against the spread.
Yeah. And the why. But opening the game at New England at -3, saying that these are even teams, that's not underestimating. Now the bettors are saying, by moving that line, that Baltimore is
exactly
a better team than New England, clearly.
Exactly.
Because coming off a 3 is a big move.
No, that's what the marketplace reflects right now. That's a huge move on such a public game, too.
You're saying, and this is the way Marco always says it, is New England just has to win at home. I mean,
exactly.
As good as, if I recall, Pittsburgh was about pick at New England last year, mm-hmm, with Castle late in the season. And so you're saying, and clearly New England came in as the favorite in the NFL.
And most people I'm talking to are saying you will not see that 3 again. It's gone as low as 1.5 offshore.
Okay, we got a minute left. How good is Denver? Because Denver is an example of a team that's doing a lot better than expected. And in theory, that line is supposed to be adjusted quickly, though I'm not so sure. How good is Denver?
Brandon Stokley's catch springboarded this 3-0, I believe that. I think this team's better than anyone believed. Let's not forget, this line got steamed, their season total over-under wins. It got steamed to the under by the wise guys. They thought this was going to be a bad team, Denver. And the marketplace, I don't think, has caught up with them being 3-0. I don't think they're a great 3-0 team, but I think they're better than the marketplace gives them credit for. Look, they're a 3-point dog at home. Not an easy place to win.
All right, we're up against it. Good stuff. Next up, we have the big game preview for college football. That's Oklahoma and Miami of Florida. And remember, you can get all of our videos at pregame.tv or go to iTunes, search for pregame.com, and you can download and listen. We'll be right back.